Your Excellencies, the Presidents of Benin and Senegal, Your Excellency, the Vice President of Cote d'Ivoire, President of the African Development Bank, Secretary General of the African Union, Commissioner of the African Union Commission, my cabinet colleague, Shri Arun Jaitley, Chief Minister of Gujarat, Shri Vijay Rupani, distinguished guests and brothers and sisters from Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, we are gathered today in the state of Gujarat. The Gujarati flair for business is well known. Gujaratis are also famous for their love of Africa. As an Indian and a Gujarati, I'm very happy that this meeting is being held in India and that too in Gujarat. India has had strong ties with Africa for centuries. Historically, communities from Western India, especially Gujarat, and the eastern coast of Africa have settled in each other's lands. The Siddhis of India are said to have come from East Africa. The Bohra communities in coastal Kenya date back to the 12th century. Vasco da Gama is said to have reached Calicut with the help of a Gujarati sailor from Malindi. The Daos of Gujarat took merchandise in both directions. Ancient links between societies have also enriched our culture. The rich Swahili language includes many Hindi words. During the colonial era, 32,000 Indians came to Kenya to build the iconic Mombasa Uganda Railway. Many lost their lives during this railway construction. Around 6,000 of them stayed back and bought their families. Many of them started small businesses called dukas and came to be known as Dukan Balaj. Apne tya dukan ke ne, ene tya dukaj ke che. During the colonial years, merchants, artisans, and later officials, teachers, doctors, and other professionals went to East and West Africa, creating a vibrant community which combines the best of India and Africa. Mahatma Gandhi, another Gujarati, perfected his tools of non-violence struggle in South Africa. He also visited Tanzania in 1912. Along with Gopal Krishna Gokhale. several leaders of Indian origin supported strongly and fought alongside the leaders of Africa's struggles for independence, including Mr. Nyerere, Mr. Kenyatta, and Nelson Mandela. After the freedom struggle, several leaders of Indian origin were also appointed in the cabinets of Tanzania and South Africa. There are at least 6 Tanzanians of Indian origin who are now serving as a members of parliament in Tanzania. The trade union movement of East Africa was started by Makhan Singh. It was during the trade union meetings that the first call of Kenyan independence was sounded. M.A. Desai and Pio Gama Pinto participated actively in Kenya's independence struggle. The then Prime Minister sent an Indian members of parliament, Diwan Chamanlal, to be part of Kenyatta's defense team when the latter was imprisoned and tried during the Kapenguria trial in 1953. The defense team included 2 other persons of Indian origin. India was steadfast in its support for Africa's freedom. Nelson Mandela said, and I quote, "India came to our aid. India came to our aid when the rest of the world stood by or gave succor to our oppressors. When the doors of international councils were closed, India opened the way. You took up our battles as if they were your own," unquote. Over decades, our ties have become stronger. After assuming office in 2014, I have made Africa a top priority for India's foreign and economic policy. The year 2015 was a watershed. The 3rd India-Africa summit held that year was attended by all 54 African countries having diplomatic relations with India. A record 41 African countries participated at the level of heads of the state or a government. Since 2015, I have visited 6 African countries: South Africa, Mozambique, Tanzania, Kenya, Mauritius, and Seychelles. Our president had visited 3 countries: Namibia, Ghana, and Ivory Coast. The vice president visited 7 countries: Morocco, Tunisia, Nigeria, Mali, Algeria, Rwanda, and Uganda. I am proud to say that there is no country in Africa that has not been visited by an Indian minister in the last 3 years. Friends, from a time when we mainly had mercantile and maritime links between Mombasa and Mumbai, we have today this annual meeting which connects Abidjan and Ahmedabad. Business links between Bamako and Bangalore. Cricketing links between Chennai and Cape Town. Development links between Delhi and Dakar. This brings me to our development cooperation. India's partnership with Africa is based on a model of cooperation which is responsive to the needs of African countries. It is demand-driven and free of conditions. As one plank of this cooperation, India extends lines of credit through India's Exim Bank. 152 credits have been extended to 44 countries for a total amount of nearly $8 billion. During the third India-Africa Forum Summit, India offered $10 billion for development projects over the next 5 years. We also offered grant assistance of $600 million. India is proud of its educational and technical ties with Africa. 13 current former presidents, prime ministers, and vice presidents in Africa have attended educational or training institutions in India. 6 current or former chief of armed forces in Africa train in India's military institutions. 2 current ministers of the interior have attended Indian institutions. Under the popular India Technical and Economic Cooperation Program, more than 33,000 scholarships have been offered to officials from African countries since 2007. One of our best partnerships in the area of skills is the training of solar mamas. Every year, 80 African women are trained in India to work on solar panels and circuits. After that training, they go back and literally electrify their communities. Each woman is responsible for electrifying 50 houses in her community on return. And you'll be surprised, a necessary condition for the women to be selected is that they be illiterate or semi-literate. They also learn several other skills like basket making, beekeeping, and kitchen gardening during their stay. We have successfully completed the Pan-Africa e-network project for telemedicine and tele-network covering 48 African countries. 5 leading universities in India offered certificate, undergraduate, and postgraduate programs. 12 super speciality hospitals offered consultations and continuous medical education. Around 7,000 students have concluded their studies. We will soon launch the next phase. We will soon successfully complete the cotton technical assistance program for our African countries, launched in 2012. The project was implemented in Benin, Burkina Faso, Chad, Malawi, Nigeria, and Uganda. Friends, Africa-India trade has multiplied in the last 15 years. It has doubled in the last 5 years to reach nearly $72 billion in 2014-15. India's commodity trade with Africa in 2015-16 was higher than our commodity trade with the United States of America. India is also working with United States and Japan to support development in Africa. I gladly recall my detailed conversation with Prime Minister Abe during my visit to Tokyo, Japan. We discussed our commitment for enhancing growth prospects for all. In our joint declaration, we mention an Asia-Africa growth corridor and propose further conversations with our brothers and sisters from Africa. Indian and Japanese research institutions have come up with a vision document. I congratulate RIS, ERIA, NIDE, JETRO for their efforts in putting it together. This was done in consultation with think tanks from Africa. I understand the vision document would be presented at the board meeting later. The idea is that India and Japan, with other willing partners, would explore joint initiatives in skills, health, infrastructure, manufacturing, and connectivity. Our partnership is not confined to governments alone. India's private sector is at the forefront of driving this impetus. From 1996 to 2016, Africa accounted for nearly one-fifth of Indian overseas direct investments. India is the fifth largest country investing in the continent, with investments over the past 20 years amounting $54 billion, creating a job for Africans. We are encouraged by the response of African countries to the International Solar Alliance Initiative, which was launched at the UN Climate Change Conference in Paris in November 2015. The alliance is conceived as a coalition of countries rich in solar resources to address the special energy needs. I am happy to note that the many African countries have supported this initiative. As a founder of the New Development Bank, popularly called the BRICS Bank, India has consistently supported establishment of a regional center in South Africa. This will provide a platform to promote collaboration between NDB and other development partners, including African Development Bank. India joined the African Development Fund in 1982 and the African Development Bank in 1983. India has contributed to all of its the bank's general capital increases. For the most recent African Development Fund replacement, India pledged $29 million. We have contributed to the highly indebted poor countries and multilateral debt reduction initiatives. On the sidelines of these meetings, the government of India is organizing a conference and dialogue in partnership with the Confederation of Indian Industry. There is also an exhibition in association with the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry. The focus areas range from agriculture to innovation and startups and other themes. The theme of this event is transforming agriculture for wealth creation in Africa. This is an area where India and the bank can fruitfully join hands. I have already mentioned the Cotton Technical Assistance Program. Here in India, I have launched an initiative to double farmers' incomes by 2022. It will require concerted steps ranging from improved seeds and optimal inputs to reduce crop losses and better marketing infrastructure. India is keen to learn from your experiences as we proceed on this initiative. My African brothers and sisters, many of the challenges we face are the same. Uplifting our farmers and the poor, empowering women, ensuring our rural communities have access to finance, building infrastructure, we have to do this within financial constraints. We have to maintain macroeconomic stability so that inflation is controlled and our balance of payments is stable. There is much for us to gain by sharing our experiences on all these fronts. For example, in our push to a less cash economy, we have learned from the great strides that African countries like Kenya have made in the area of mobile banking, M-Paisa. I'm happy to share that India has, in the last 3 years, improved on all macroeconomic indicators. The fiscal deficit, balance of payments deficit, and inflation are down. The GDP growth rate, foreign exchange reserves, and public capital investments are up. At the same time, we have made big strides in development. Mr. President of the African Development Bank, it is reported that you have described our recent stamps as textbook chapter for other developing nations and called us a development beacon. While thanking you for these kind words, I'm also glad to know that you have spent quite some time training in Hyderabad earlier. However, I must say that I remain focused on the many challenges ahead. In that context, I thought I could share with you some of the strategies we have used in the last 3 years. By paying subsidies directly to the poor rather than indirectly through price concessions, we have achieved large fiscal savings. In cooking gas alone, we have saved over $4 billion in 3 years. In addition, I appeal to well-off citizens to voluntarily give up their gas subsidy. Under the Give It Up campaign, we promise the saving would be used to provide a connection to a poor family. You will be surprised to know that over 10 million Indians volunteered to do so. Thanks to the savings, we have launched a program to provide gas connection to 50 million poor families. More than 15 million connections have already been provided. This transforms the lives of the rural women. It frees them from the health hazards of cooking with firewood. It also protects the environment and reduces pollution. It is an example of what I call reform to transform, a concentrated set of actions which transforms lives. Some of the subsidized urea fertilizer intended for farmers used to get illegally diverted to non-agriculture uses like production of chemicals. We introduce universal neem coating urea. This makes the fertilizer unsuitable for diversion. Not only have we got substantial financial savings, but in addition, the studies have shown that neem coating has improved the effectiveness of the fertilizer. We are also providing our farmers with soil health cards, which tell them the exact nature of their soil and advise on the best mix of inputs. This promotes optimal use of inputs and increase crop yield. We have made unprecedented increase in capital investment in infrastructure covering railways, highways, power, and gas pipelines. By next year, no village in India will be without electricity. Our clean Ganga, renewable energy, digital India, smart cities, housing for all, and Skill India missions are preparing us for a cleaner, more prosperous, faster growing, and modern new India. Our aim is that India must be an engine of growth as well as an example in climate-friendly development in the years to come. There are two crucial factors which have helped us. The first set of changes is in the banking system. In the last 3 years, we have achieved universal banking. We launched the Janadhan Yojana for People's Money campaign, under which our 280 million bank accounts have been opened for the poor in urban-rural areas. Thanks to the initiative, virtually every Indian family has a bank account. Normally, banks are associated with helping businesses and the rich. We have enlisted them for helping the poor in their quest for development. We have strengthened our state-owned banks by freeing them from political decisions and appointing professional chief executives on merit through a transparent selection process. Our universal biometric identification system called Aadhaar has been the second crucial element. It prevents claiming of benefits by those who are not eligible. It enables us to ensure that those who deserve government aid receive it with ease while excluding non-genuine claims. Friends, let me conclude by wishing you a very successful and productive annual meeting. In the sports arena, India cannot compete with Africa in long distance running. But I can assure you that India will always stand with you, shoulder to shoulder, supporting you in the long and difficult race for a better future. Excellencies and ladies and gentlemen, I now have a great pleasure in officially declaring the annual meetings of the Board of Governors of the African Development Bank Group open. Thank you.